That song gets me. There's no valley that's too low. How many feel that witness? There's no place that's too far. Wherever you lead me, I will go, go, go. There's no mountain that's too high. Come on, sing it like you mean it. There's no valley that's too low. There's no place that's too far. Wherever you lead me, I will go. One more time, come on. There's no mountain that's too high. No, it ain't, Lord. There's no valley that's too low. There's no place that's too far. Wherever you lead me, I will go. I'll go. I'll go. Wherever you lead me, Jesus, I'll go. Oh, somebody just lift your hands up and tell him that. Wherever you lead me, Jesus, I'll go. Wherever you lead me, Jesus, I'll go. One more time. Your hands together for the Lord tonight. You can be seated in His presence. Are we going to walk the word tonight? Because, Lord have mercy, I was looking at Sister Tanya and I told her, I said, you know, Sister Tanya, I said, this is the kind of meeting here that can go on for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks, because the ground has been broken up and there's such an awesomeness in the atmosphere. And sometimes you just hate to quit. I looked over there, I said, Lord have mercy, Pastor Van Johnson wasn't here. I said, we'd keep going. Because I'm telling you, there's something, it's hard in these days to get people's hearts open up to a move of God. And when you got their hearts open, then the Lord can do what He desires to do in them. Amen, somebody? He's been allowing me for the last 4 to 5 nights to really, some of you may not have understand what I was doing, but you have to plow in the spirit realm before you can plant a word. And so many times we try to plant in a person's heart when the heart is not properly prepared to receive that word. And I'll tell you why, and I'm going to say this, because I'm learning every day that when the Lord began to minister to us, that the words that God, and I want you to hear me say this so plainly, the words that God is speaking, He is not speaking to us to touch us. When He speaks a word to us, He is eternalizing us. Come on now, you got to come on up with me, because I'm not going low tonight. He is eternalizing us. He is eternalizing us. Every time He speaks a word in us, it is a word that is supposed to last throughout eternity. He's already eternal. You understand what I'm saying? So He's not speaking something and then a week later, it's no longer there in your heart. He is preparing word is not in your spirit, then it cannot survive eternity. Oh, Jesus. Did you hear that? If his word is not in your spirit, then your spirit, when it lays down and is called out of the grave on resurrection day, cannot live throughout eternity. In other words, it is the word of God that quickens and resurrects. So if the word of God does not get planted in you when he cracks the sky, you cannot get up. Can I teach that tonight? There is no resurrection for you. You're dead. You cannot get up. You cannot be resurrected. You cannot live throughout eternity. And that is the reason why when we come to the house of God and the choir sings and the praise and worship go forth and all of that, why do you think that as soon as the word start coming, the enemy try to bring distractions? Because he knows that if that word ever hits your belly and survive and stay, you are destined for eternity. Y'all ain't saying nothing here. I know everybody been running around preaching money is coming and God give me to bless you. But the Holy Ghost told me that you better be reminded that you got to get into the kingdom of God. That when he calls your name, you better be able to answer him. We in this thing for eternal life, not for a new car. Saved for new furniture. I didn't get saved for a husband. If I don't ever get married, I want eternal life. We gotta get in. And that's what the devil fights ministries like Dr. Hinton's, because they preach get in ministries. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Or the quick blessing won't pacify us. But I tell you what, I tell you, come to church and we're going to pray and God going to give you a breakthrough. And so the majority of the people in the audience are looking for a breakthrough that is tangible. But I believe that somebody in here tonight is looking for a breakthrough that is eternal for their spirit man. See, now why does God have me teaching like this tonight? He said because of the fact that we do not have a lot of, and hear me when I say this, in this hour, a lot of backslidings. Remember in the old days, they used to say, you know, Sister so-and-so is backslide, or Brother so-and-so, he backslid. And so there is not a lot of backslidings in this hour, but there are masses of people that are coming. But the Lord began to show me something very, very, very powerful. He said the reason why we do not have a lot of backslidings is because people are not really getting saved for real. Oh, I'm not going to get a lot of amens now. Because somebody somewhere, wherever it is you came from, is teaching you the kind of gospel that says, well, it's all right. Well, you know, you tried. But I remember when Missionary Cox and Rosemary Gage was preaching to us and Pastor Kenton, I'm telling you, there's a power that is in the preached gospel for real. I'm not talking about people that's got a gift. Because when you have a gift to preach, all you can do is ignite a person's emotions. But when you are anointed to preach, because your life is purified, then when you preach the gospel, sin is broken over the lives of God's people, and they are saved from the animals to the gallimals. Say for real, that thing, watch this, that thing gets down in your belly. Good God, I wish I had somebody in here that understand what I'm talking about. We're not seeing enough belly salvation. I'm not hearing nobody. Well, he touched me. Well, I went to church and I cried. couldn't stop crying. Or the service was so high that I fell out. But I'm not talking about high, and I'm not talking about falling out. I'm talking about is the trainer, which is the Holy Spirit, is the trainer in your belly telling you the do's and don'ts of this thing called salvation. Y'all sit down. I'm gonna teach this. Right now you've been saved. You've been saved a year. If you don't hear a voice in your belly after a year speaking to you and saying, don't touch that, don't go there, put that down, then you ain't got it for real. Because the Bible said the Spirit of the Lord would lead and guide you into all truth. Not a weak salvation. We feed off all of this junk because somebody who's not ready to come out of sin themselves, they preach a gospel that they can live by. They're not preaching this gospel that says touch not, handle not, taste not. They're not preaching this gospel that says set no evil thing before your eyes. Can I teach? You look around now and words like sanctification, justification, purification ain't even hardly used no more. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Because nobody hardly, and I say hardly, I sit sometime listening to the word network, and I sit at home all day long, and one preacher after the next come on the word next one. And I said, well, when is somebody going to start talking about purification of the heart? Jesus have mercy. I'm talking about salvation for real. Turn to Psalms 51. And I'm going to paraphrase behind you with the Amplified Bible. Read it.
Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts.
Behold, God, you're desiring truth in the inner being.
And in the hidden part, thou shalt make me to know wisdom.
And make me, therefore, to know wisdom.
Purge me with hyssop.
Wait a minute. To know wisdom in my inmost heart. Way of the Lord in my inmost heart. Well, why? Because the Bible said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. That means everything that you are right now, everything that we can see about you. Some of y'all says this, and let me correct this, because I've been hearing this a lot, a whole lot lately in the church that says, well, you know what? I ain't gonna let nobody judge me, because you know what? The Bible said that God look on the heart, and man look on the outward appearance, and God look on the heart, so I ain't gonna let nobody judge you. Well, all right, all right, all right, I agree with that. I agree that God looks on the inward part. But guess what? If I walk up to an orange tree and I saw oranges, I can declare that that is an orange tree. And though God looks at your heart, the manifestation that comes out in your flesh is a representation of what's in your heart. Somebody. See, the church has been caught up now with rebuking symptoms. getting to the root of the matter. See, a kiss is a symptom. A tongue kiss is the symptom. But the real root of the thing is the spirit of lust. Y'all ain't saying nothing. So every time you kiss, and that's not your husband, and that's not your wife, you are showing forth a manifestation of the lust that's in your heart. What happens is you don't have to say to somebody, judge me. Everything that you do, if you were to sit here for the next 60 seconds and think about your whole lifestyle over the last week, then you can begin to say, he said, honesty and truth in your inmost heart. Then you can begin to write that on a piece of paper tonight. I got lust, I lie, I cheat. Y'all ain't saying nothing. I got jealousy, I got envy. Oh, y'all ain't gonna let me. Y'all ain't gonna let me say stuff like that, because I know we don't teach a sound gospel like that anymore. Because the Bible said in the last days that the love of many shall wax cold. It said in the last days that we would not endure sound doctrine. Truth. No, you're reaching over here and God is saying truth. Up in the house of God in your heart. Oh, you dress for church, but your heart. Somebody said, well, you know what? What happened to your ministry? Because I can remember when, you know, I mean, it seemed like, oh, Prophet Bynum, you know, it seemed like you done blew up. Well, what did you do? How did you pray? And I said, you know what? The Lord got a hold to me one day, and he said, stop praying to be famous and pray to be purified. And so he took me on a consecration to get the junk out of my heart. Y'all ain't saying nothing here. I had to go all the way back to my childhood and begin to forgive people that had offended me. I can't hear nobody right now. I had to dig up junk about myself that I never told anybody. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Are you hearing what God is saying? He said, I can't take you to the heights until my power go into the depths of your heart. Purify your heart. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Somebody said, well, I want him to purify. Well, then, how does, watch this, how does he purify? Come on now. What is his method of purification? Because we're such pretenders and we're such protectors of our image. Oh my God, he said, he that seeketh to save his own life shall lose it. In other words, he's saying, if you want my life, then lose yours. I don't care about it. Jesus couldn't do anything until his reputation was destroyed. See, that's what I'm talking about the spirit of pride that's in the church. Until this happened, the power of God, like tonight, can be in this place. And because you are Sister Watermelon in your church, and everybody know that you're the evangelist, or everybody know you're the preacher, and you know in your heart that you need to come to the altar and be refreshed, you will let your title keep you in your seat. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Do I have a witness in here tonight? You got to keep yourself in the frame of mind. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Because that's where I am pursuing me to the altar. I don't care where my name is. I've got to make it in. I got to make my way to the altar. He said, how does he purify? Because we, watch this, we as human beings, we would never just dig up stuff and say, you know what, God, you know, he kind of after this. Because what happens is we mask ourselves. We put on such good images. So then what God does is he lets you sing in the choir. He lets you get on the usher board. He says, here you go. I feel that of the Lord that he want me to be usher. Or I feel that of the Lord that he want me, God want me in a choir. So he'll let you be an usher and you will be ushering and loving God and doing fine. And then one day out of the clear blue, he'll let somebody come to church that ain't quite delivered. And they'll want to sit in one place and you will want them to sit someplace else. And then they'll cuss you out. And then you will turn around and cuss them. And see, then here you go. Then God said, that right there. That's what I'm after right there. But see, except I provoked that spirit to surface, you would have pretended like it wasn't there. Now, come on, be honest. Some of y'all will still cuss. Some of y'all will still lie. Y'all ain't saying nothing. But God, after this service, is going to begin to put you in situations that every demon spirit that is lodged in your belly that has no business there, it's going to surface because he's going to purify. He said, all right, all right, all right. Something happened. You mad? I'm after that. All right, they lying on you and you got to go tell your side? I'm after that. Okay, they gossiping about you and it ain't the truth and you want to go around and correct it? I'm after that. Y'all ain't saying nothing. I don't hear nobody right there. Okay, you want to go and run around and straighten out gossip? I'm after that. Because I got to teach you how to hear the lies and keep going. I got to teach you. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. He said, you still want to fight your battle. I'm trying to get you to a point where you will die to your flesh and die to your ideas and say to God, not my will, but thine will be done. I'm after that. That's what I'm after. Watch this. I'm after everything that causes you to step to the left outside of God. Oh, I don't hear nobody saying nothing right there. That's why he got some people on your job and in your life and in your family that rubs you the wrong way. No, God is not going to change them. God is going to use them to purify you. He's going to use them to make you shut your mouth. He's going to keep on letting them come after you until they roll off your back like water on a duck's back, because I'm trying to purify you. I ain't getting no amens right there. Boy, the amen's real low right there. Well, God, do something with Sister So-and-so because she really coming against me. Nope, I got her coming against you because I got an anointing over your life and I want to use her to cause that temper to surface. Y'all ain't saying nothing. No, 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 baby, I got you there because you're my servant. I'm going to use you to my glory, but I can't take you to the top. I can't take you in ministry with an attitude. I can't take you with that temper. I can't take you with a lying spirit. Y'all ain't hearing me. That's why I'll let you walk in church and they can't find you no seat. I gotta kill pride in you. I gotta get you to the point. But if they sit me in the bathroom, it's all right. I don't have to have a special seat. Y'all sit down. So much power. You got so much Holy Ghost. You got that much power, then sit in the back. You that much on fire for God, then lead the power back there. Y'all ain't saying nothing in here. You got that much power, I can sit in the vestibule area. Oh, I don't hear nobody right there. I don't hear nobody right there. The old saints used to tell us that the weak saints belong on the front row. But you got the strong saints fighting for the front row. Get your end back there somewhere and sit down next to a prostitute and cast some demons out. preach tonight. You don't want me to preach tonight. Too many big eyes in the church. Too many No, you go somewhere and die. Y'all ain't saying nothing back in here. I'm talking about a purified heart. Read the Bible.
Purge me with hyssop.
Purify me with hyssop.
And I shall be clean.
And I shall be clean.
Wash me.
Ceremonially.
And I shall be white.
Wait, because my Bible says ceremonially. That means there ought to be, Pastor Hinton, a certain time, I don't know about y'all, but a certain place that you remember, Pastor Tom, when that thing came out. See, if you don't remember when God drove a demon out, then it may not be out. God, I can't get no amens right there. I remember the very day lust came out. Y'all ain't gonna let me testify in here tonight. How do you know it's gone? Full of the Holy Ghost that testified to your deliverance. Because see, a lot of us run out here claiming stuff that we got and we ain't got it. I remember growing up in the church and seeking for the Holy Ghost, and I just be speaking, and I came out of tongues and I told Mother Carol, I said, I got the Holy Ghost. She said, baby, no, you don't. See, it ain't like it is now.
Receive it, there it is.
Y'all don't want me to test. I'm messing up bad now. You ain't labor, you ain't travail, you ain't did nothing. Can't nobody blow nothing on you. That's a lie from the pit of hell. Get it. And then you go, that's it. You weak as water, and that's why your character haven't changed. Y'all don't like me tonight. That's why your outer man still look like it did when you was in the world. That's why don't nobody know you saved but you. Y'all ain't saying nothing here. The Bible said that when he comes into your life, he said all things are passed away, and behold, all your hairstyle, everything about you becomes new. Y'all don't want me to teach that now. Now I'm meddling, I know it. You've been saved now 6 years, skirt still up to here. Something wrong. I'm gonna preach it here tonight. I'm gonna preach it here tonight. You on the bandage board with your cleavage all the way down here, something wrong. I can't hear nobody in here tonight. You've been saved not for 10 years with an earring in your nose. What's wrong with you? I can't get no amens in here tonight. Pants all skin tight. We can see everything you got. Tell me I got the Holy Ghost. Where is it? Because a trainer ought to be in your belly. He ought to be talking to you. Y'all ain't saying that. I can't get no amens in here. And I hear some of y'all know, well, why she teaching like that? Well, that ain't number legalism. Well, that ain't number bondage. Well, that ain't a no, baby. Look, my Bible tell me that we're supposed to be slaves. You're free in your spirit, but your body is supposed to be a slave. That Bible says that we are, watch this, prisoners. Now, I went to the prison, and I went in there to preach to the women. When I got in the prison, you didn't look over there and one girl had an orange dress, and it was way up here. Somebody else had a green dress, and it had a split all the way up here. Somebody, y'all ain't saying nothing. All them girls that had on orange shoes and green uniforms, because they're prisoners. And I didn't have to walk in there and wonder who was the prisoners and who was the visitors. I ain't getting no amens now. And it's a shame that that's the way it is in the body of Christ. We got to wonder who is the saved people and who is the unsaved people. The Bible says you were tonight. Yeah, because the book of 1 Corinthians said, I decided to tell you something, but I can't tell you, too immature. You can't handle it. Y'all ain't saying, oh God, I want to know the deep thing. Deep things? First, pull your dress down. How am I going to tell you a divine revelation? Because I can't even get you to dress right. How am I going to take you behind the veil? Y'all ain't saying nothing here. Lord, I can't get nobody. If you can't hear me tell you that your skirt too tight, how you going to hear me tell you some divine revelation? You ain't far enough to hear purification. You ain't far enough to hear revelation. All that stuff that you make, well, you know what? The Spirit of the Lord, people kill me with that. And you know, God told me. I mean, God ain't telling you nothing. I'm going to tell you who's talking to you. A familiar spirit that is aware of God. A demon that used to be around the throne that knows the ways of God. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Are you hearing me? And that's why we better get careful that we don't get caught up with familiar spirits that has taken us beyond our purification. You preach it on the mountaintop, but your life is in the valley. Read the Bible.
Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow.
And I shall, watch this, in reality, be whiter than snow. Now, watch this. He said, her Bible said, wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. And some of y'all take that like it's some kind of paraphrase. Oh, I said, no, my Bible just said, wash me, and in reality, that means for real. In other words, if I don't wash you, then I can't strengthen. Watch this. See, I was reading something the other day about vitamins, because you know God just took me on this whole new health regime, and I said God, so I had this man to come to a class I was teaching to talk about health, and so he said, well, I got this whole vitamin package that's gonna really just change your life, and this protein shake and everything is in it and all that. So the girl gave me the stuff, and I said to her, now I'm really excited about taking my vitamins because they say it's gonna make me feel better, and taking my little protein thing and little herbs and all that stuff. And I said, well, I'm excited about taking it. I said, so can I start tomorrow? And the man said, no, you can't start tomorrow. So they went down the back, he said, because you gotta take this first. I said, but what is this? He said, we gotta detox you. He said, we gotta clean your colon out. Y'all ain't saying. He said, because every disease starts in the colon. So we gotta clean your colon out. Watch this. Then we gotta detox your blood. Now watch this. He said, now in that package, when you get through detoxing and cleansing, then I gotta give you something that's called a good bacteria, which is acidophilus. A good bacteria. Listen to this. A good bacteria. Bacteria, you associate that with something harsh. So see, when he cleans your heart, then he gotta send me with a good bacteria. A harsh cleansing. And so you gotta put that good bacteria in that body. And what it does is it creates enzymes. Now, if there is no enzyme in the body, then the vitamin has nothing to nourish.
Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Now, I didn't know this. I didn't know that enzymes is what causes the cells and the skin and the body to replenish itself. So if you have no enzymes, you are dying. So then you got people that are in the world that are taking vitamins, yes, and low on enzymes. So the vitamins is going in the colon and coming out in the stool. Right. And they finding out that they're still malnourished. What am I saying? You can't eat this world and God ain't in there. That's why some of y'all are always, you know, I read my Bible. I know my Bible. My Bible is lined up. I got all kind of colors in it. I said in my Bible, but you haven't changed. because God ain't in there. The enzyme is not in there to connect itself with that work. Are you hearing what I'm saying? He never came in your life for real. You cried in church, but you was not transformed. How do you know when you are transformed? Because when you get out of church, ain't nobody gotta tell you what you need to throw out. You leave out of church and you say, the world, I don't want no more. Too much pampering going on. Don't you want to be saved? Don't you love the Lord? Don't you want Jesus? At least little thing happened, you don't show up at church. Well, go get her, because she offended. She hurt. You ain't been to church in 2 weeks. What happened? Well, I don't want to talk about it. And they said something hurt me. So I just decided not to come. And then here we go. Well, why you didn't come to church? Well, I didn't have no coffee. And didn't nobody come pick me up. And I came to church and y'all ain't got no love in this church. And y'all ain't got, oh, somebody ought to go somewhere and lay down. Because when you was out there in the street and in the tavern and in the drug den, you got there the best way you can. Honey, you took off your shoes and you walked. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You thumbed the ride. Y'all ain't saying, we don't want God like we pretend that we want him. Because if you want him, you will start at 5 o'clock. You will walk to church if you have to. If you really want God for real, you will get on the bus. Are you hearing me? You don't want no God because you ain't saved. James 1. Are we gonna walk through this? Yes, we is. Go to the 13th verse in the first chapter.
Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God.
Wait, you don't understand something. I'm going through something. And look, read it.
For God cannot be tempted.
For God is incapable of being tempted. Read it.
With evil.
By what is evil?
Neither tempteth he any man.
And he himself tempts no one. Off doctrine. But God allowed it to happen. He did that. He tempted me. Make you feel better when you fall. Y'all ain't saying nothing. But what did he say? Read it.
But every man is tempted.
But every person is tempted.
When he is drawn away of his own lust.
When he is drawn away, enticed, and baited by his own evil desire. Y'all, I gotta say that one more time. He is baited. Oh God, I wish I had somebody to understand that. No, you did it. Okay, I still can't get no amens right there. It's your own mess. Okay, I still can't get nobody to understand that. You've been saved for 6 years, but you never went through the class of purification. So every time you are tempted with the mess that's been left in the reservoir of your spirit. Get saved. You got to get purified. Father God, come into my life. Forgive me of all my sins. Wash me in your blood. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I love you. I accept you as my personal Savior. Watch this. Salvation is an event. Sanctification is a process. So now what we have going on across the country, as big as day, is you got many people coming to the event, but nobody's going through the process. Out of my belly. It got washed out through the word. The Bible worship team, not through the choir, not through your singing tapes, but the word. Can I teach tonight? So now we don't watch this. Watch this, watch this. So we don't want to endure that kind of line up on line. Precept upon precept. Do y'all know if I had about another week, honey, I would take the sins of this world night by night. I'm talking about the kind of preaching that hits your devil. How do I know it's real preaching? That when they hit something that you know you're dealing with, it ought to make you mad. You ought to feel a warfare going on inside of you, where part of you is saying, who she thinks she is? And the other part is saying, help me, God, and cleanse me. One part is saying, I'm not going to give it up. And the other part is saying, oh, yes, I am. Because the Bible says there is a war going on in my members, trying to bring me under subjection. Some of y'all, watch this. Some of y'all ain't in no battle. Your belly is not in a battle. Your belly has never been in a battle. Oh, Jesus. You don't even know what a battleground is, because you let your flesh do whatever it wants to do. Y'all ain't saying nothing. And this is how you treat your salvation. Well, you know what? God is good. Well, he merciful. But that's all right, honey. He forgive me. Well, you know what? I know what I'm going to do is wrong. But girl, you know, I just can't help you. That's all right. Because you know what? God forgive. Yes, he does. But I'm going to tell you what. He forgives. And he washes. And he's merciful. But there is a judgment behind everything that you do. The Bible says you're going to have to give an account for every deed that is done in the flesh. God, I can't get no anybody right there. To say amen. You act like, wait a minute. Let me help you out with your salvation. You act like some, well, you know what? I came to the altar one day and they was making an altar call, and I just came because I just felt like it was time. And you know, I made up in my mind. Baby, you did not make up in your mind. The Bible said that you were shaping in iniquity. You were born and shaped in sin. Your mind was turned over to the devil. Are you crazy or something? You didn't make up in your mind. Honey, listen, when you were in your sins, before the foundation of the world, he chose you. That's why your mama may go to hell. That's why your cousins may go. But he chose you. He snapped your mind and gave you a desire to be saved. And then you're going to get over here and act like you came by yourself. I'm going to tell you something. You better stop that mess. Because one time you're going to step out and you're not going to get back. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Your friends still in the tavern. Your girlfriends still in sin. Well, if it's that easy to come out, then why don't they just come out? I just said something. I need an answer. If it's that easy to make up in your mind to be saved, then why do you have to pray so hard for your loved ones to be saved? Because you're praying that God would have mercy. You're praying that God has possibly chosen them. Do you not know that everybody in your family ain't chosen? God, I wish I had somebody understand that God has selected a few. Do you know the privilege that we have right now to be able to say that we know God? What about the people who believe in Hindu? What's wrong with them? The devil got their mind. You can't believe God unless he snapped your mind. You can't understand God unless he reveals himself. You ought to be praising God like you done lost your mind, that he has revealed to you the true and the living God. You could be stuck sitting there. You could be stuck somewhere in some off doctrine. You can be chanting Buddha, thinking that you're right. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You can be into Hinduism, thinking that you got it right. You can be in Muslims thinking that you're serving the right God. I can't get no amens right here. You can be believing in the mothership and the crystal ball. Y'all ain't saying nothing. But look at what he did for you with your nasty, no good self. Look at how he picks you up. Look at how he keep messing with you. And you got the nerve to get an attitude when you feel God tugging on you. Are you sick? You ought to praise God every time you feel that tug. Every time you feel convicted about doing something, you ought to go to praising God, because that's God letting you know that you still belong to him. If you didn't belong to God, he'll let you do what you want to do. You wouldn't have no conviction. Your conviction is an honor. You ought to praise God for being convicted. You ought to praise God because there is some things that the Holy Ghost won't let you do. You shouldn't feel bad if God told you to stop. You ought to rejoice that God is getting you ready for eternal life. It would scare me to death if I couldn't hear from God. It would scare me to death if I would sit and watch something on television and I don't feel my spirit jump and nothing convicts me. That would scare me to death, Elder Hinton. If I heard something on the radio and my spirit didn't say turn the channel, it would bother me to no end. Are you hearing what I'm saying? If I cuss somebody out and I didn't feel no conviction, but every time I feel that conviction, I say, God, I praise you because I'm still yours. Because you chastise those that you love. Because you rebuke your sons and your daughters. I'm glad I'm not a bastard. I'm glad I'm a child of the King. I'm glad I belong to him. I gotta praise him. Sit down, I gotta tell you this. We are baited. The devil, watch this. Good God, have mercy. The enemy does not know the end of your purification. He cannot walk that distance or he will become purified. So he only knows the end of your destruction. When he sees that we are steps away from being purified, he cannot hinder or stop us from the end of our purification. Lord have mercy, watch this. God, I hear you. I hear you, God, I hear you. So he reached back to the spirit of familiarity of who you were like when he had you. And you can always tell when you are being purified. Because out of nowhere, you will see a boyfriend that you ain't seen in 10 years. Y'all ain't saying nothing. All of a sudden, he allowed you to have desires for things that you ain't desired years and years. Y'all ain't saying nothing. If you used to smoke crack, all of a sudden you've been free 6 years and you feel like you want to hit a, you want to hit that pipe one more time. You know why? Because the devil said one more try. Because you know what? I know they own their way to being purified, but all I got to do, if I can just bait them, if I can bait them out of the will of God, if I can show them one more time how good it used to feel, how bad they wanted, how much they used to like it, I can stop the purification. So he brings in, watch this, familiar desires of my old nature trying to wake up my old man. He knows that I am laying back here dead in trespasses and sins. He knows that. He knew the day that God woke me up and changed my place. He know what I'm headed in another direction. But he knows what my strong man used to be. Because everybody in here got one something that is in their life that keeps on tugging at you. I don't care how long you've been saved, it keep on tugging at you. Don't you want to do it one more time? Don't you want to do it just one more time? Don't you like how I feel? Just sneak one more time. Because what the devil recognizes is this, and that is, watch this, it takes you months and weeks and fast and hours of prayer to purify, and it takes you 1 second to blow it off. Y'all ain't saying nothing. That's the kind of power he got. He said, in 1 second I can knock you out the kingdom. With one temptation, I can get you to change your mind. You can been to live saved for 10 years and been on 40-day fast and consecration, and one bait can get you out of God's will. But what God is doing tonight, he's opening up your eyes, and you're going to be able to look at the temptation and say, no, devil, not this time. Not this time. I done paid a price. I done fasted too long. I done prayed too hard. I'm not going back. Somebody in here ought to turn around and tell three people, I ain't going back. I ain't going back. No, you ain't saying that like you mean it. You better tell somebody, I done came too far. Somebody tell somebody, I ain't everything God want me to be, but I ain't going back to what I used to be. I'm sorry, I done came too far. He said,
then when lust hath conceived,
wait a minute. He said, lust and passion. What did he say? Now, I'm finna show you something. What did he say?
Then when lust hath conceived.
Start over and read that, because I want to get the whole flow of that. Read that again.
But every man is tempted.
Tempted.
When he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed.
Uh-huh.
Then when lust hath conceived.
Watch this. Watch this. You are baited. Mm-hmm. He's showing you the process right here. It don't just jump. See, I gotta help somebody. Something came over me. I don't know what happened. It just overtook me, and before I knew it, I had done it. That is a lie from the pit of hell. Every sin that is committed is not an instant act. It is a process. You were first baited. You had to take it. You had to digest it, and it had to be conceived. Me. You sit up. One night I was sitting up, Pastor Hinton, I was watching television. I was watching something. Friends or something came on one night about 11 o'clock, and I'm watching television, watching Friends. And so Friends went off, and a movie came on. And so the people was, you know, the movie was a good movie. And so when it got to the point where the people started taking off their clothes, Holy Ghost said, turn the TV. So I just said, just a little second. I said, I ain't gonna do nothing, because I'm beyond that. It don't bother me, you know. I miss no more sheets. I've already made up my mind, I ain't going back. So I watched it a little bit, and then I turned. Minutes of it, and I turned it. Now, when I turned it, Pastor Hinton, I had been in revival preaching, and 2 days later I was going back in a meeting, so I was still feeling strong in God. But what I didn't realize, I had been baited and a seed had been planted. And then 2 weeks later, when I stopped preaching and came out the revival, I started feeling lust burning in my heart. And I said, God, what is wrong? He said, 2 weeks ago, you got baited. It took, oh, y'all ain't saying that. It was conceived. Now it stayed there, and now it's mature. And when it's mature, it's ready to operate. you, sweetheart. He don't bait you just when you're weak. No, the manifestation of what's been baited happens when you're weak. You're baited when you're strong. You're baited because it has to be deception. He has to make you think that your spirit man is strong at the handling and it ain't bothering you. Y'all ain't saying nothing in here. And so what that devil does, he sit back in there and he wait until you ain't prayerful. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Read the Bible, what it say?
Then when lust hath conceived.
When lust hath conceived.
It bringeth forth death.
No. Conceive. That means when it has gotten down in you. And it has been mixed. Watch this. It has found the place of your old desire. Like a husband and a wife. It has created a baby. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. That's why we got to purify. Because Jesus said, when the prince of this world cometh, he finds none of him in me. That's why we keep falling, because too much of the prince is found in us. So when he watches, so when he comes, he finds an identification. Can I help you with that? That's why people say, well, you know what? When I turn on the radio, I got Luther Vandross tapes. They don't bother me. There ain't nothing wrong with just listening to it. There's good music he can sing. Well, Whitney stuff don't bother me. Honey, I listen to, you know, say my name, tell me that you love me. Oh, that don't bother me. That don't bother me. You know why? You know why there is no conviction in you for the things of the world? Because that thing have found an identification in there. See, you cannot be convicted by something that you can identify with. I wish I had somebody say amen right there. You cannot be convicted of something that's already in there. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The reason why you're not convicted of it is because it's found a relative in you. It's just like eating something that is foreign. Now, for the last few months, the Lord has completely taken me off of meat. So the other night, I ordered something from the room service, and they had some rice in there, and they had these little chunks of meat I've been paying attention to. I was almost done eating. But instantly, not even 30 minutes later, I had to run to the bathroom because my stomach rejected it. Because it was foreign to my belly. Y'all ain't saying nothing. And that's what ought to happen when we get something foreign. We ought to run to the altar and ask God for a washing and a cleansing before that thing become mature. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Y'all got too many grown up devils in y'all. Come on, I'm going to teach this thing right here. You got stuff that's done got old and mature and got gray hair. It's time to be purged. It's time to be washed. See, you gotta die while you got strength to die. Can I bring that out? Because some of y'all, why do you think we got old people in the church that's mean as the devil? Why do you think we got people in their 60s and 70s still having a lust problem? Because it takes strength to die. Y'all ain't saying nothing. It takes strength to fast and consecrate. And that's why you gotta die when you're in your youth. Y'all ain't saying nothing in here. That's why you gotta purify while you're young enough to purify. Read the Bible.
Then when lust hath conceived,
uh-huh,
it bringeth forth sin.
Uh-huh.
And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death.
Now it said it bring forth death, but go to 2 Peter, the first chapter. 2nd verse.
Grace and peace be multiplied.
Grace and peace be multiplied.
Unto you through the knowledge of God.
Through, watch this. Through the knowledge of God.
And of Jesus our Lord.
Uh-huh. Pray for me. I'm a little confused. I'm not here. I just don't know which way I'm going. The devil just messing with me. And I just been going through so much stuff. And if I just could talk to problems about it. And if I could just talk to Pastor Hinton. And if I just, Pastor Collins could just talk to me. I'm just so confused in my mind. I'm just going through so much. I just feel like I may have a nerve. You don't have the knowledge of God. Because the Bible said, when you have the knowledge of Jesus Christ, then grace and peace will be multiplied. Read the Bible.
According as his divine power.
Look how quiet I got right there. Because see what I'm doing tonight? Let me help you with something. I'm, I, I, I'm snatching crutches and pacifiers. I notice every time I get on something real strong like that, Pastor Tom, everybody just gets so quiet, just so like, where she, where? I just think everybody need to be counseled. And where she, you don't counsel demons. What's wrong with us? We done counsel folks demons, and now we done train. Do you not know that instead of us in the business now of casting out devils and getting people free, we are now monitoring and training demons? You got people across the country, and I've seen it happen before. That's over the choir, full of the devil, mean as a rattlesnake. Everybody in the choir don't like her. She said, but do y'all just understand, Sister Gwen, because she done come a long way. I remember when she was a little girl, and she got a little temper, but she gonna be all right. Training demons. Y'all ain't saying that. Raising devils. Y'all ain't saying nothing in here. You don't count to the lust devil, you cast him out. I'm not gonna tell you how to ease at the house with Johnny, and you've been shacking with him for 20 years. The Bible said that if he's not your husband, and she's not your wife, it is an abomination to God. What do you want me to tell you? Stay there 20 more days. Ease out. In God's timing, he gonna help you to walk out. And I done seen too many women. Go home and said, you know what, I love you. But if we ain't finna get married. Cause why buy the cow when you can get the milk free? Cause I wanna be saved for real. Who am I talking to tonight? Ain't no such thing as I can't help it. Your belly ain't pure, that's why you can't help it. A person that is on crack is because that thing is in their colon. Every craving comes from your colon. Did you know that? If you can get them to a rehab center and clean their colon out, the cravings will stop. Y'all listen, the cravings is not in their heart, it's in their colon. And the reason why you keep craving stuff that you have no business craving is because the colon of your spirit have not been cleansed. God, I wish I had some more time in here.